again, a very disappointing loss for the Kingston Frontenacs to open the second half of the OHL season. They fall 4-1 to the rival Belleville Bulls. Tyler King back in studio alongside Tim Cunningham. And Tim, we mentioned briefly in the postgame, the Fronts have to get off to a quick start if they want to get back in the playoff race, and obviously games like tonight aren't going to help.
Not at all. I mean, they're in such a deep hole right now. I saw that Matt King mentioned to you that he thought they have to win between 20 and 25 games in the second half. And, you know, that's a clip that I just right now, the way they play tonight, given the fact that who Belleville was missing, I can't see it. But saying that, you know, they do have to catch Niagara or Peterborough, but they've got to win 20 games. They haven't been able to win 7, and we're now 37 games into the season. So pretty steep mountain to climb.
And, of course, we can't say it's over until it's mathematically over. And at the same time, though, Tim, we will probably hear, you know, the Frontenacs were missing Maverick Parks. They were missing Erica Branson. Getting back into the race isn't out of the question. I think you'd agree.
No, it's not out of the question, but then you're missing some guys out of your lineup, but that's going to happen come playoff time as well. So what happens to you if you're going into the playoff game, into a playoff series without Maverick Parks? I mean, you've got to find ways to win, and teams that get into the playoffs do that. And you know, they had some good effort at times tonight, but it's about getting pucks in the net and doing the things, the simple things. We saw a number of times tonight where the Frontenacs had great chances to get good hard shots at Murphy, and they're trying to feather a pass or trying to take a shot that could be deflected. I mean, those are high-risk, high-reward shots, but, I mean, there are only a couple leagues in the world that works consistently, and when you're struggling at 7 wins so far into a season, you got to simplify your game.
Now let's talk a bit about Mike Murphy, a guy who's quickly becoming the pride of the Kingston area, considering he's never lost to the Frontenacs in regulation in his career. A great game tonight, although the Frontenacs, as you mentioned, with trouble getting shots on net, that doesn't take away from a great performance by Mike Murphy.
Oh, no. I mean, Murphy was a big difference. I thought Brandon Mashinter was also a huge player. I thought he was a big difference tonight for Belleville up front, given the fact that who were they missing, Tangrady and Subban, and Mashinter with his size, Mashinter with his size, he's going to be a big addition to this Belleville team. But again, getting back to Mike Murphy, very solid, and a kid that I think is one of the top goaltenders of his age in the world. And again, I'm surprised that he's not with the national team, but I know, you know, it's a tough choice. I'm surprised he wasn't even invited to give it a shot. But somebody that's really, he's going to be able to carry this Belleville team a long way, and I look for them to go a long way into the playoffs and perhaps in the Eastern Conference. Not much of a prognosticator, but I can see it coming down to Brampton and Belleville in the Eastern Conference final.
Oh, certainly, and we mentioned Belleville is going to be in a tough fight for first place, and perhaps the greatest sign we saw tonight, Belleville really acting like a first place team because they were in tough. They had lost some of their big scores, and they looked no worse for wear. Early on in the first period, they seemed pretty fatigued, but I think it was amazing the way they turned around by the halfway point of the game.
Well, I think George Burnett had a lot to do with that. I mean, I know, George, we were saying that after last night's loss to St. Mike's at home, that, you know, you'd sort of write that one off being the first game back from Christmas, but when they came out flat in the first period, I know George, as I said earlier, became pretty animated behind the bench, and he demands 110% all the time, and he wasn't getting it, and then got it, and they eased off the gas pedal a little bit in the second period, but scoring 9 seconds into the third, it was game over right there.
Oh, certainly. And back to the Frontenacs for a second. You know, Tim, the attendance tonight wasn't announced, which is obviously never a good sign, and we've mentioned this on various post-game shows. For the Frontenacs, I have to get your thoughts on this as well. The newspaper story came out while we were on break that City Council is going to call the Frontenacs in to address this whole situation. Is it perhaps maybe being blown a bit out of proportion?
Well, first of all, tonight's attendance, I've been to weddings with more people. I mean, it was really disappointing. But in terms of City Council calling the Frontenacs into a council meeting, I think that's a lot of smoke, because the Frontenacs are a tenant of the building. They're not beholding to City Council for anything. There's nothing. Mind you, I haven't read the lease, but I can only assume what's in it, that they don't have to answer to City Council for, you know, let's be fair to the Frontenacs. It was City Council that set the numbers, that set the budget, not the Frontenacs. They're a tenant. And, you know, I think this is completely unfair to the Frontenacs to suggest that anybody has to go in front of City Council to answer about their attendance woes. I mean, they've got other, you know, do they have attendance woes? Absolutely. We have a vested interest in this building. But I think City Council getting involved is politicizing a problem that's even bigger. And we've got to, there are better ways to solve this problem than to get City Council involved.
And a final note on that, Tim, I think someone who's really getting a bad rap over this whole situation is Jeff Stilwell, the marketing director for the Frontenacs, because in the media we keep hearing, you know, City Council has trouble with the Frontenacs marketing plan. What is wrong with the Frontenacs marketing situation when we've mentioned so often on Cogeco, winning is the best marketing? And it comes down to a marketing strategy. I don't think so. I don't think there's anything wrong with the Frontenacs marketing strategy. Is it maybe time for these media sources to get down and admit it's down to winning? It's not down to what Jeff Stilwell can advertise out in the community.
Other than giving away free money and giving away money, I mean, that's one way you can get people in here. But winning 20 or 25 games, I mean, cures a lot of problems. And Jeff does an outstanding job. I mean, he's a guy that wears probably about six or seven hats with this club, and he's in a thankless position. And I think he does an outstanding job. And he's always available to the media. He's always, you know, I've never seen Jeff Stilwell have a bad day, and I'm sure he's had some bad days. But they do run good promotions here. They do run stuff. I mean, there's a lot more stuff going on in this building than there was in the Memorial Center. So in terms of an in-game presentation, there's stuff going on. Is there stuff they could do better? Sure. I mean, but that's I think you're getting nitpicking. If you want people in the building, put a good hockey club on the ice and get some wins, and that is going to solve your attendance problem right there. And any team will tell any, you know, if you just be around hockey long enough, put a good product on the ice, they will come. We saw that last week with the U.S. and Russia here. The place was packed. So,
well, it's amazing that we're the only two that seem to notice this. I don't understand how that's even possible.
I think the 4,000 people that weren't here tonight noticed it as well. So,
sorry. Final thing for you, Tim. Now, as you mentioned, we can't keep focusing on this off-the-ice stuff. It's down to the on-the-ice product. So let's finish by talking about the on-the-ice product, which will be facing the Ottawa 67s on Tuesday. The last time the Frontenacs won, it was against the Ottawa 67s. It was a huge 7-2 win. This is obviously the perfect opportunity for them to try and finally get that elusive winning streak going that we haven't seen all season long.
Well, it has to start, and they've got Ottawa on Tuesday night, Oshawa Friday night. They've got to put two in a row here because they haven't put two in a row together all season, and it's got to start. Ottawa's a team they've had success with over the last couple of years, and the Ottawa. I haven't seen Ottawa play a good game in here since they've opened this building. And again, Oshawa, a team that Kingston's had success with, and two teams that are Eastern Conference teams. And if you're going to make the playoffs, you got to beat people not even Eastern Conference teams. I meant Eastern Division teams. You got to start beating teams in Eastern Division, and then they've got games with Peterborough as well, and they've got to win those games going out here.
Certainly. Well, Tim, I'll see you on Tuesday, and hopefully I'll get to host a win for once.
Yeah, well, hopefully you do.
All right, that's Tim Cunningham. We'll take a final look at your upcoming broadcast here on the Cogeco Network. Of course, on Tuesday at 7 p.m., we'll have the Ottawa 67s coming into Kingston, see if they can break that losing streak yet again. And for those of you watching in Belleville, Thursday, January the 1st, a New Year's Day, 2 p.m. from the Peterborough Memorial Center, we'll have the Bulls in at Peterborough. So for David Murphy, Tim Cunningham, and our entire TV Cogeco crew, this is Tyler King saying good night and thanks for watching.